Good Saturday morning. Today is a wonderful day. Today is a beautiful day. Today we have Bible study and communion together. And then today I am going to the 50th anniversary celebration for Maurice and Vivian Banks. And then I'm leaving straight from there and driving out into southern Maryland to go to the wedding of Patrick Froh Jr. and Melinda Hammond. And I am so excited. Melinda has a little boy, so today Patrick becomes a daddy and a husband on the same day. And it's awesome and it's wonderful. Today, this is my hat. I'm going to be wearing this to the wedding. And I love it. I love this beautiful hat. I'm going to wear it to church tomorrow, and then it will probably be on sale. I'm not sure, because I really like this hat. I bought it specifically for this jacket, which I also love. I got the outlet over at Tanger Outlets. And so today is a good day. Today is a really good day. If you don't know Patrick Jr., Patrick Froh Jr., he is a wonderful young man. He has been wanting a good wife for a long time, and somebody who would love him and he could love and make a family with. And he certainly found that in Melinda. I've been doing counseling with them for the last over a year now. And they're just the sweetest little couple. And I could not be more proud for Patrick and for Melinda. They're both getting a good thing in their life. And little Matthew is going to have these awesome parents and a good life. And Melinda's mother, I think, is helping provide them with a home. So all is well. All is well. And I'm going to go out there and celebrate. But first, I'm going to go over to Maurice and Vivian's 50th anniversary celebration. And what a great event for these two things to happen on the same day. Because here is Maurice and Vivian, who have the three daughters. And they've lived their life beautifully together. And now they're going to celebrate their 50th anniversary today on the same day that I get to go out and celebrate with Patrick and Melinda. So today's an awesome day. Tomorrow's going to be incredible too. Tomorrow morning, Steve will be continuing in his series From the Cross to Pentecost. And I'm just super excited. So let me tell you, Kathy Wright and I yesterday, we had a girls' day, and we both got a haircut, and I may or may not have gotten blonder yesterday. I'm loving it. I'm really loving it. I got the back cut short. Super cute. I love it. I love it. I've not had short hair in the back since the first of the pandemic. And then once it started growing off, Steve was kind of like, oh, I kind of like long hair. And I was kind of like, ugh, I hate long hair on me. So I love it on other people. I love it on other people, but this girl, not so much. And so we had a good day yesterday. And then last night, Friday night prayer. Have a look at it on YouTube or NCG Live or on Facebook, because we had a good time. We had such a powerful presence in that house last night. And so good times. Today we are going to be taking communion. So if you need to grab your elements really, really quick. Let me tell you something that happened to me this morning. They say joy comes in the morning. And I don't know if I would even classify this as joy comes in the morning. But I got some clarity this morning. I woke up this morning with clarity on a situation that I've really been thinking about and struggling. Yeah, Barbara was there. I saw you, Barbara. It's so wonderful. It's just so wonderful to be there in the presence of the Lord. And as we talked last night about being in the presence of the Lord, and all the different ones were praying. So this situation that I've really been praying about, and I've got a couple of people praying with me about it, and I've just woke up this morning with clarity. I'm good, and I can't wait to get in that van and drive with my sweetheart. Listen, when Steve and I are out in our vehicle, it is not wasted time. It is not. And sometimes, I'll tell you, sometimes we are talking about, I'll have a question about a scripture or something, and we get started talking about that. We're also, of course, talking about you, all of you, we have discussed and loved on. And then, you know, we have a big family. Steve and I have a big family. We have four children and four children-in-law, and we have 11 grandchildren. I've got my two sisters, and they've got pretty good-sized families themselves. And, of course, we're talking about that, and we're praying about that. But we get a lot of stuff solved and worked on. And so I cannot wait to get in that car today with Steve and just talk to him about, I just really feel clarity brings peace, and peace allows joy. Thank you, Sally. That's why that's my sister. That's why, as the older sister, she just takes care of me, and she explains things to me. Clarity brings peace, and peace allows joy. I'm ready for it. I'm good. Thank you, Sally. You are a good older sister. All right, so today we are going to continue looking at promises, and I want us to look at Joshua 21 and 43. We're going to start there, Joshua 21 and 43. Joshua 21 and 43. Now, Joshua 21 starts with the towns for the Levites. Towns for the Levites. And I'm going to tell you the truth. When I'm reading scripture and I'm just going straight through or whatever, when I come to this begat, and so-and-so lived in so-and-so, and then his children lived in so-and-so, I skip over those sometimes. I probably should not confess that, because I know my child watches this, a couple of my children do, and so I should not confess that, but it's the truth. Sometimes when I got to get to begat, and then from, and then to, and then fro, sometimes I don't read all of those. And it's a shame, because there's pretty good stuff hidden in there, but we're not going to read it today. You read that today. By the way, Steve told us last night that everyone should read John, the 21st chapter, before service in the morning. So we have that assignment. John, the 21st chapter, before service in the morning. But we're going to look at Joshua 21 today. And we're going to skip over all the, here they go. But you should read those. Because one of them is, okay, that piece of land was assigned to people who were accused of murder. You know, I'm like, okay. That's their town. That's their little place. Everybody, you know, got a place as was promised. So then we look at 43. So the Lord gave Israel all the land he had sworn or promised to give their forefathers. And they took possession of it and settled there. The Lord gave them rest on every side, just as he had sworn to their forefathers. Not one of their enemies withstood them. The Lord handed all of their enemies over to them. Not one of all the Lord's good promises to the house of Israel failed. Every one was fulfilled. I'm going to tell you something. Honestly, we could sit right here for a month, because this has got just, if we just took it apart, piece by piece by piece, it says, so the Lord gave Israel all the land he had sworn to them. I'm not sure what God has promised you, but this says he has sworn this to them, even the one who had been accused of murder. Even the one who had been accused of murder. And it's not just a place for him to hide out. It says it's a refuge for him. And then he gave them rest from all of their neighbors, from all of their enemies. He gave them rest from all of their enemies. And then it says, and he handed their enemies over to them. He said, okay, here's your enemies. I'm fulfilling my promises to you. I'm fulfilling what I swore to your forefathers. I'm fulfilling what I swore to your parents, because this is a case of descendants, descendants, descendants. When God makes a promise into our lives, it goes not just into our lives, but it does go into our lives. But it goes next, 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 next. I married an only child. That's wisdom. I married an only child. I don't have to share that boy with anybody. I married an only child. So when his parents passed, everything just went to Steve. Now, some things had my name included. There were a couple of things that were just for me, but everything went to Steve. But when my mother-in-law bought her house back in 99, somewhere in there. When Mildred bought that house in Cleveland, here's what she said to me. Because I said to her, that doesn't look like a house you would buy. And she said, no, it's not a house I would buy. Because she said, I would have chosen a brick house. So I said, well, then why on earth did you choose the house you chose? She said, I think it looks like your house. I think it looks like a house you would love. And so I'm leaving that house to you, Janice. So she would say that to everybody who would listen. Well, that's Janice's house. When she had a caregiver come in, and the caregiver would say, well, I don't really want to do that to this house. And I said, well, I do. And Mildred turned around and she said, this is Janice's house. In other words, this is the chain of command. This is Janice's house. Now, someday, maybe that I will live in that house. And maybe I will pass that on down to my children. Or maybe it will go a different way. There will be a different chain. But anything that God puts into your life, then if you take care of it, if you settle there, if you possess it, then it's yours. And then you can pass it right on down. And that means if God puts a blessing on my life, and don't think about money right now, just think about blessings on my life, then I'm going to pass that down, pass that down, pass that down. My mother had this goofy cowlick. Put mine back down. My son Mike, same cowlick, same place, sticks up the same way, cute as a button on his face. Our grandson Oscar, cowlick, right there, cute as a button on his little face. I don't know how many generations from now they'll have a little cowlick right there, but here's what I know. The joy of the Lord, the peace of the Lord, the satisfaction of the Lord, that is being put into my life, and I'm going to possess it, and I'm going to settle there. What Sally said is right. Peace allows joy. When you are at peace, you can find joy. And when you have peace and joy in your life, that is what God has promised you and he's putting into your life. But you have to possess it. You have to own it. You have to say, this is mine. Thank you. This is mine. This is part of my life, and I'm going to possess it. I'm going to own it. So what land has God given you? What property has God given you? What space? What peace? What joy? What gift? What ministry? What fellowship? What friends? What family has God given you for you to possess it? And maybe you're thinking, I'm really not worthy of any of that. It says, give them a city of refuge for one accused of murder. For one accused of murder. I doubt you've gone beyond that. I don't know what would be beyond that. A place of refuge. A place of refuge. Look around your home right now, wherever it is that you are, wherever it is that you're living, whether it's you're in a hotel room for a minute or wherever it is, and God has given you that as a place of refuge. And we live there. We possess it. We take it. And we own it. It says he gave them rest on every side. Now, let me show you this. No, that's the wrong one. This bookmark that Janet Murray gave me for Christmas, It says, about Benjamin, he said, let the beloved of the Lord rest secure in him, for he shields him all day long. And the one the Lord loves rests between his shoulders. Excuse me, I got the hiccups. About Benjamin, he said. Let's say, about Janice, he said. About Sally, he said. About Linda, he said. About Angela, he said. Let the beloved of the Lord rest secure in him, for he shields him all day long, and the one the Lord loves rests between his shoulders. Deuteronomy 33:12. Thank you, Janet. Deuteronomy 33:12. About Janet, he said. About Sabrina, he said. Let the beloved of the Lord rest secure in him, for he shields him all day long, and the one the Lord loves rests between his shoulders. We go through stuff. We go through stuff. I just told you. I'm dealing with a situation that is just, in some ways, just tearing me apart. I mean, there's so many ways this thing could go. As Sally says, it's got so many moving parts. And yet, day after day after day after day after day, my children are calling me and saying, let me tell you what happened today. I went in and talked to my supervisor today, and I was worried about it, and I was dreading it because it could have gone so badly. And instead, they welcomed me in. They talked to me and they said, let me help you with this arrangement. Let me tell you something, people. When God puts something in your life, then he lets you rest between his shoulders. Settle there. Settle there. Because the next verse I want to share with you is in Acts 2 and 35. Acts 2. No, not 35. Acts. Well, I've read all over the place. So let me start at 38. Acts 2, 38. Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you. Now, this is in answer to the question of what shall we do? What are we going to do? How can we get out of this where we're in a mess and we're under condemnation? How do we get out of this? What shall we do? I've written over here in huge letters on the side, what shall we do? And Peter says, well, repent and be baptized. Repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Steve led us all last night in the sinner's prayer. What shall we do? Repent. Then find some place and be baptized. Repent, be baptized, every one of you. Now, this includes people who are really, really good people. This includes people who do good works. This includes people who really are the head of charities and help charities and fund charities. And these are people who work in shelters. These are people who are good people. It says every one of you needs to repent and be saved. Every one of you, repent, be saved, and then be baptized. Be baptized. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Holy cow. What are you going to receive? The gift of the Holy Spirit. And then it says it's promise. The promise is for you. And then look at this, and your children. It's for you and your children. And all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. For all whom the Lord our God will call. Now, I don't know if that means they're far off in another land. Or I don't know if that means they're far off away from you. Or they're far off away from the Lord. But here's what it says. I'm making this promise. What do you do? Repent. Be baptized. Repent and be baptized. Repent and be baptized. And then the promise is for you and your children and all who are far off. Every night before I go to sleep, I pray in alphabetical order for all of our family. There's 37 of us right now, but we're expecting three babies. Three babies are coming into our family. So that means, then I say baby, baby, baby. So we've got 40 in our family now. And I pray for them in alphabetical order. And then I pray, start praying for our council and our staff. And then I'm praying for those of you who are part of our church or who have started watching. It says, I can rest in Him. I can put all of those things, all of those people in His hands. Last night, the last thing I remember even thinking was, Father, I'm just going to commit this into Your hands. Not my will, but Your will be done. I woke up this morning with clarity. I woke up this morning with clarity and definitely peace. And peace allows joy. When we rest in Him, when we repent, that means we're putting everything into His hands. When we repent, that means we're saying, I am so sorry. I'm sorry. And I'm going to tell you, sometimes you can go maybe a couple of days without saying, I'm sorry for that. But sometimes it's all day long you're saying, oh, I'm sorry for that. Now, I'm not talking about begging forgiveness for the rest of your life and saying, I can't be saved. And I'm not talking about that. Because God says, if you come to me and if you humble yourself, if you ask, if you seek, if you knock, I will answer. I will be found and I will answer that door. You can be found by me. You can be blessed by me. You can turn your sin into me. And once you've given your sin to me, I'm going to get rid of it. So I'm going to fling it away into a place so far away that even I no longer know about it. It's gone. It's gone. He says, I'm going to cast that same thing so far away. My neighbor, my sweet neighbor, is out there cutting her grass. I'm going to tell you something. There are so many promises, but I want to receive. It says you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Repent, get baptized. You will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. I repented when I was 6 years old. I wanted to be baptized. I was filled with the Holy Spirit when I was 13 years old. I wanted to be baptized, but I am afraid of the water. Hans, come here. I wanted to be baptized. I wanted to be baptized, but I'm afraid of water. And how are you going to be immersed in water if you're afraid of water? I can't put my face under water. We went to Israel when Amy was 10 years old. So I was 31 years old. And there they were in the River Jordan. And I said, I'm going to get baptized today. And Amy said, me too. Me too. So the two of us, we got the robes and we got the towels and we walked out into that water. And I'm going to tell you the truth. I was terrified because I'm watching. I didn't want to be the first one. I'm watching. I'm looking. Amy, just so excited, 10 years old, big time swimmer. At that point, you know, she learned to swim when she's just a little bitty thing. And there's my husband and my father-in-law out there baptizing people. My mother-in-law was there taking pictures up on the side. And as soon as I felt Steve's arms and TL's arms around my shoulder, put my hand up on my nose, I was not afraid. I got baptized again later in the River Jordan. Steve turned around, he said, I got baptized when I was 15 years old, and he said, I want you brothers to baptize me. And so he said, I'm gonna get baptized again. And I just walked right out in that water next to my husband. I said, me too, me too. Repent, be baptized. And it says, then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And it will be this promise, will be not just to you, but to your children as well. And those who are far off, maybe those who are far off means those generations that have not yet come. I don't know exactly what that means, but I like to think that it means... Hans, come here, baby. Come here. I like to think that it means generations from now, generations from now. Receiving the Holy Spirit. Receiving the Holy Spirit. Today, as we take communion, I want us to all say the sinner's prayer together first. So, if you've never accepted Christ as your Savior, now's your chance. Maybe you're saying, but I'm not even in a church. There's nobody even to witness it. That doesn't matter. God is there to witness it. God is there. So, repeat with me. Take your wafer. Even if you've been saved 75 years, hold the wafer in your hand or whatever you're choosing. Lord, I am sorry for my sins. Lord, I ask you to forgive me of my sins. Father, I want to live in your presence. I want to stand in your presence. And Lord, I want to have eternal life. I want to have the life that you're going to provide for me here, but I want to have eternal life with you. And I ask you to forgive me. I pray today, Lord, that your mercy and your grace would fall on me and that I would stand before you clean and washed from my sins. Because, Lord, you said that if we take this communion, that as we take this communion, as it comes into our bodies, we are receiving your body into our bodies. And that until you return on that wonderful, glorious day of your second coming, Lord, we pray that you would hold us in your arms, hold us in your hands, keep us close to you. We take this communion today in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Take the wafer. I love the Lord so much. I'm so glad I'm a Christian. I'm so glad I know where to turn to when I'm in the middle of a struggle. I'm so glad when all chaos is around me that the blood of Jesus overcomes all of that. That the blood of Jesus cleanses away. That the blood of Jesus causes my enemies to succumb. That the blood of Jesus takes my fears. That the blood of Jesus helps me to fully rely on God. Let's take the juice. The blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary. It makes me clean as snow. We've said the sinner's prayer. We've received communion. We can rely on his promises. I'm so glad that in the midst of chaos, he brings me clarity and peace. Clarity and peace and joy. When I sit here before you this morning, I have a smile on my face, and I've just told you I've been through a tumultuous thing. I can truly say, I'm not faking it. You know, they say fake it till you can make it. I'm not faking it. Jesus Christ is the joy and the light of my life, and it brings me peace. And if you don't have that peace, I encourage you to find it through Jesus Christ. All right, I'm off to a 50th anniversary and a wedding. God bless you. I love you. I will not see you tomorrow morning, and I will not see you Monday morning, because Monday is my day off, and I've got big plans for Monday. So Tuesday morning, I will see you, Carolyn. So thankful for you feeling better, honey. God bless you. Love you. See you at the anniversary or at the wedding. I don't know who all's going to what all, but I will be there. And I'm super excited. So I'm going to say, God give you peace. In Christ's name. Amen.